Well, good afternoon. I am John Chandler, the principal here at Turner Middle School, and I am here today to talk a little bit about our school's performance data up to this point and just help parents navigate what we use as data points and what kind of adjustments we make. I'm going to go ahead and get started with the slideshow. As we do with all of our Douglas County School System meetings, I'm going to begin with our mission, vision, and beliefs. Our mission is we will serve our community with excellence by helping our students reach their potential as we prepare them for college and career in a safe and supportive environment. Recruiting, cultivating, and retaining the best teachers, staff, and administrators. Providing a challenging curriculum and relevant learning opportunities. Providing the highest quality instructional resources and tools, and fostering a culture of continuous improvement. All right, and our vision is to build a community of lifelong learners who become responsible individuals, independent thinkers, and productive citizens in a global society. And we believe that we must understand how children and adults can learn and continue learning, build communities of lifelong learners, cultivate the leadership potential of every employee, student, and parent in our system, be creative, energetic visionaries who respond quickly to diverse and evolving issues, meet the diverse needs of all stakeholders, students, parents, employees, and community, and maintain efficient and effective administrative processes for instruction, operations, human resources, and sound fiscal management. All right. In this session, I just kind of want to talk a little bit about 11. I'm sorry. Hold on one second. Talk a little bit about, what the data process entails and why we do frequent data checkpoints. And when the big data drops come in, how does that impact what we're doing? So I'll talk a little bit about that today. All right. As I discussed in previous Title I meetings, the school improvement plan is our roadmap to success, if you will. It's basically based on looking at how we did last school year and saying, how can we get better? And we put these action steps in place. We monitor them along the way and assign specific individuals with tasks of making sure we do what we say we're doing. All right, so let's look at our school improvement plan. All right, so this is available on our website. We do have all of our goals listed up here at the top. It doesn't look like I can highlight it. But up at the top, it says measurable outcomes, SMART goals. The essence of it is that in all tested areas, we want to increase our performance by 6%, okay? So that's what all of our goals are. If you need something quick and dirty, it's literally improve all tested areas by proficient and distinguished grade marks in all tested areas by 6%. That's where you'll see this naming system that says proficient and distinguished. Those are the two score areas that we like to measure our students and our teachers by, is proficient and distinguished. So we want to increase all tested areas proficient and distinguished percentages by 6%. All right. And as you will see, we have some goals that are tied to literacy and numeracy and writing across all content areas. Remember that will come up. Literacy is about reading skills. Numeracy is about math, language acquisition, and writing is also a strong form of measurement that we use. And all of these areas down here are these action steps. Talk to us about specific steps we're going to implement throughout the year to get to where we're going. I'll talk more in depth about those as we go along. All right. So now let's look at some of the data sources that we want to cite. I want to share with you what the staff at our school looks at when we're talking about making sure that we're aiming for our school improvement plan targets. All right. So let's talk a little bit about non-academic data sources that we look at every single day, every week, every 4.5 week checkpoint, and obviously every 9 weeks. We look at attendance data, we look at discipline data, and pulse data. Pulse is the survey that you guys take that just is perception data about how you feel about the school. So teachers take that, parents take that, and students take that. I'm going to look at some of the student data today because it's important. You know, we're trying to teach our students, you know, to acquire this academic knowledge. But as we know with Maslow's hierarchy of needs, if students don't feel safe and connected, then they won't learn anything from us. So it's important that we look at how they feel about going here. So those are non-academic indicators. Our academic data that we look at is our STAR data, which is a milestone assessment predictor, the Wright score, which is a milestone predictor. We look at teacher grade profiles because obviously we have standards-based classrooms and the teachers are teaching the standards that are going to be tested on the milestone. So we like to think that our teachers' grade profiles are a good indicator of students and how they're going to perform on this GMAS. And the GMAS data is used to calculate our CCRPI. All right. That's our college and career readiness performance indicator. All right. So let's dive in a little bit. All right. So our attendance data. These are our four categories that we look at by grade level. And this is since the first day of school. So right now, we want all of our kids to be in one of the blue sections. Satisfactory means that they are not missing days. They're not on a trajectory to miss 10 or more days of school this year based on their attendance patterns. And so if we look, we have about 27% of our 26% of our sixth graders are in a chronic or severe pattern. Doesn't mean they've reached it yet, but it does mean that they are at risk. So 26% of our kids in sixth grade, that's about 40 kids. All right. So then if we look at, I'm using the wrong mouse. we have about 30% of our seventh graders who are demonstrating at risk, chronic or severe absenteeism. They're on a trajectory to miss way more days than we're comfortable with. And then we obviously have 33% of our eighth graders who are demonstrating that. So, you know, a lot of things go into our attendance data. You know, we obviously factor in things like COVID quarantines, and we're recommending that, you know, if kids are sick, to please keep them home. That's one category of students. But then, you know, we also have students who have behavioral situations that requires to have them out of school for a longer period of time. So we're balancing keeping the school safe with, you know, keeping kids out of school. So we do have some factors in place, like our student engagement specialist, Mr. Beasley. His task is having a caseload of all of these kids that are showing chronic or severe absenteeism and try to make sure that he's engaging them and engaging their families to make sure that they understand the importance of attendance. All right. The next thing I want to talk about is discipline data. So if we look at this, this is the number of discipline incidents by grade level. As we can see, the seventh graders are a busy bunch. Again, most of our infractions this year have been class disruption or just what we like to call nuisance type behaviors, and not anything where there's victim-based behavior. So we're thankful that our behaviors are not those of a serious nature on a high level of frequency. However, we definitely are putting things in place such as PBIS, which is our positive behavior interventions and supports. We're trying to make sure that we incentivize good behavior. Our teachers are giving out rewards to students. Our teachers are, you know, recommending students to be students of the week, and we're recognizing them in our newsletter and on social media. So all of those things play a part into our efforts in reducing discipline incidents. The Pulse survey. So what you're looking at, these are pillars. And so our students take these surveys and they give us a ranking on a scale of 1 to 10. And the gray bars that you see are the district averages. The yellow bars indicate where our school performs. So health and well-being, our 5.8 out of 10 of our students say that we think that that is important to us. Okay. 6.0 out of 10 of our students say that they like school. You know, that's troubling. While we wish more students said that, it's one thing to note is that 6.9 out of 10 district-wide. So we're not that far from the district average. My education, this one says that how they feel the importance of their education. So obviously middle school, we're trying to introduce them to the idea of life after high school, whether it be employment, enlistment, or enrollment into a college. We're starting to think about those things right now. Dr. Smith, you know, you're one of the people who are a parent and a teacher at our school. And I want to point out, here's a specific example of teachers trying to make sure that that's relevant. You know, Dr. Smith has a college corner outside of her room. She talks to the kids about, hey, this college does this college does that. And you have the theme of a different world in your classroom just to get kids talking about, you know, life after high school. So those are some of the steps that we're using to try to get our kids to value.
Hello, can you hear?
Hey, Ms. Strickland, we can hear you. How you doing? Ms. Strickland, can you hear us? Let me see if I can mute you. And Ms. Fulton's here too. Thank you, Ms. Fulton, for joining us. I appreciate you coming. All right. And so the last pillar on this page is my school. And so this is how much they like their school. So obviously we're way off on this one. 5.3 out of 10. The district average being 6.5. You know, it's a really big goal of mine to make students like coming to school here. It's one task to get them to like coming to school. That's another big task to make them like or want to come to school here. So those are a couple of big items that I want to share on the student survey, and then let's go with the other ones. All right, so the next one says relationship with students. So basically how well they get along with each other. As you can see, this is our second lowest area of concern. So we're working hard at making sure that, you know, we're encouraging students to tell us when they're unhappy about their interactions with other kids, etc. Their relationship with teachers is well below the district average, so we're working hard at improving that too, by building positive relationships between teachers and students. Reward and recognition, this is one of our highest pillars. Again, we talk about students of the week every week and our 4.5 week celebrations called Fresh Air Fridays. So we're working hard at doing that. And school culture is a tricky one because I don't necessarily know that the questions lend themselves to really developing what the definition of school culture is. You know, it's really the way we do things here. And obviously every student wishes we did everything a little bit differently. So just kind of giving you guys some insight on how we use this data. We look at this every Monday in my administrative team meeting. We talk about how students feel and how teachers feel and how parents feel, and just try to attack our lowest pillars to make sure that we're in good shape and trying to address them. All right, now let's look at some of our GMAS predictors. This is our academic data that we look at. So the right score gives us an idea of how well students write. We just took the right score and we're disaggregating that data as we speak. Just trying to find ways to find the weak links in students and their writing abilities, because they will have to write on the GMAS in the grade assessment. And so what we want to do right now, we have a period of the day called extended learning time. Every morning from 9 until 9:40, students go to one of their class periods throughout the week, and they target specific things. So one of the challenges that the English department has taken is they're going to use the right score data from the assessment we just gave and they are going to break their students down into groups based on their biggest deficit area. And they're going to target those students all the way up until April when we take the test. So we're going to take their weakest area, put them with a teacher every morning or once a week with a specific teacher to work specifically on that deficit area. All right. The next academic data we use is the STAR assessment. The STAR assessment is a benchmark data where we do STAR reading and STAR math. And it measures, they took it at the beginning of the year in August, and it measured where they are after the summer. Our goal is that after 9 weeks of instruction or 18 weeks of instruction, students will experience some degree of growth. They may not be, you know, so there are two things we care about. Obviously, achievement, but we also want to celebrate growth. You know, that's definitely something that, again, goes back to celebration. A student may have tested on a third grade level as a sixth grader in reading or math in August, but now that we're in December and they just took the test, we would certainly want them to have progressed accordingly, perhaps even outgrown the time they've been in school. So that's what we use the STAR data for, is to see where they start and where they are now. I'm sorry, we still got some programs going on after school. I hope it's not too loud. And then another test that's similar to this is the Beacon. We're looking at giving that benchmark sometime in January or February. It's the same platform as the GMAS, and you know, as the old saying goes, you should practice how you play. And so because it's the identical platform, we want the students to practice in that same environment so that they can be used to where to click the mouse, how to find their calculator, how to highlight things when they're reading and annotate text. And that'll give us a good idea of where we think kids are gonna land. The whole idea of these GMAS predictors is we don't like surprises in April. So the more we know going into it, the better, right? And so one of the other academic things that we look at is grade profiles. So based on this, I'm looking at the blue bars, guys. That's our core classes. Those are the ones that are tested. The connections classes are not tested, but I just put them up for comparison. So at 9 weeks, 54%, let's say A's, B's, and C's are the kids that are proficient and distinguished, or the P and D that we talked about earlier. So we've got, my mental math is about to start working here. So 47% plus 34% is 81%. I think that's right, 81%. So if 81% of our students are on target in their classes to being proficient and distinguished, we'd be in great shape. This is not a good correlation, though. It's more realistic based on the scores I'm going to show you on the next screen that this is probably a more accurate descriptor, which is the 34% plus 20%, which is 54%. That aligns more with where we're scoring on the GMAS data. So our goal, remember, we want to celebrate growth. This 27% of kids right here, we are encouraging our teachers to push them. All of our C's, we want to turn them into B's. That's trying to use language that parents can relate to, because when I say level threes and level fours, it's not really language that we grew up using. But we all know about A's, B's, C's, D's, and F's. So I want to just make sure that you understand where this 27% of kids right here, they're our main focus group. But we also want to celebrate this group of kids right here if they can get out of the F range and get into the D range. Obviously, we want the F range on the testing to be our lowest value, or our level ones, because we get a few points for level twos, and we obviously have pushed students from a level one to a two. But what we aim for is level three and level four. All right. So let me show you what our CCRPI came out November 16th. And so this is basically how we did. And I took the other schools in the district out because that's none of our business. You know, it's good to know where we line up in the district, but you know, when it looks at one school to another, but my teachers don't teach at those schools, and those teachers don't teach at mine, and those students don't go to my school. But I do like averages. Averages are really good for us simply because they kind of let us know where we stand. Okay, their statistics is the great equalizer. So the weighted percent of students scoring at developing learner, which is on level two, or above on the milestones in English, we are about 8 points below the district, okay? 53%. It's not horrible, but obviously we got a lot of room to grow. All right, the weighted percent of students scoring at developing learner or above in mathematics is quite low. So we're pouring a lot of our efforts into our mathematics practice, which is goes back to our school improvement plan about numeracy across the curriculum. So for example, social studies teachers and science teachers can help teach math standards when they are teaching map reading or graph readings about populations using the language of math standards in the classroom when you're teaching other subjects. So it's highly important that we make sure that we understand the urgency of our math deficits. All right, the next bullet says weighted percent of students scoring at developing learner or above on science. That's quite low also when compared with the district average, where I'm about half of it. I would like to point out that one of the things that, you know, we've addressed, we didn't have a teacher for, we were missing two teachers in that subject area last school year. We do have teachers to teach our kids in the eighth grade science course this year. So they're not being taught by a computer. So that's hopefully a step in the right direction where we'll see some gains this year. And then the next one says, weighted percent of students scoring developing learner or above on the milestones in social studies. Again, that's also a lower one, but obviously math and science are these are on fire. This is an urgent matter right now. So what we want to do is pour a lot of our resources into our math and our science right now, okay? And so when you average all those together, we come out with 42.3. We're about 14 points lower than the district and about 18 points lower than the state. So we got some work to do here. And we're gonna see if some of the fruits of our labor prove prosperous. That was alliteration, right, Dr. Smith? All right, a few more data points. Percent of students in grades 6 through 8 demonstrating reading comprehension at or above the midpoint of the college and career ready stretch Lexile for each grade level. Let me shorten that for you. Kids reading on grade level. 45% of our kids, about 46% of our kids read on grade level. So, you know, we could spend a lot of time saying they didn't come to us ready, but they're ours now. So we're focusing on literacy across the curriculum. Again, we're focusing a lot of our strategies and time on improving reading because we're doing it in every subject area, even math. It's not the sole responsibility of English teachers to teach reading. So we're putting a lot of emphasis on that. And then finally, percent of students earning a passing score in things other than core credits. Well, we do well in that, right? Because we have an awesome band program, an awesome chorus program. We have interesting connections that we're offering that give students a break from the core subjects, and they seem to really like it. We're right at the district average, and we even exceed the state average. So our overall readiness score is not far off from the district, obviously because of how well we do with our extracurricular activities. And then we have about 40% of our population are from families that English is not necessarily their native language. They're of Hispanic origin. But we do have about 100 of our students, which is about 18% of our kids in our, here it is right here, English learners percentage, 27.5%. These are students who are in our monitored English language acquisition program, and they take the access test. So 57.75% of those students, you know, we exceeded the district and the state on that. So that program is doing very well. We actually just earned another full-time teacher. So we're happy about that. We feel like the smaller classes mixed with good teaching will yield good results. And hopefully that number will grow. This year, or last school year, we were 69.3% economically disadvantaged, or students on free and reduced lunch. I do want to say this number is important to us, even though this number tells us how students eat their lunch, how they pay for their lunch. It doesn't tell us how they learn. But it does give us a good correlation through research that students who come from economically disadvantaged situations tend to have more of a deficit when they arrive at school. And so that's where, you know, we've talked before about how Title I is the program that provides assistance to schools in closing that economic gap so that we can provide additional resources to close the achievement and the opportunity gap for students from economically disadvantaged situations. And we have about an average percentage of students with disabilities. Our school is not much different than most others when it comes to students with disabilities, but we do have quite a high population of English learners and economically disadvantaged students. So it's okay. We are good with pushing rocks uphill, so to speak, metaphorically. You know, we have more students who need more attention. And thankfully, we got the right staff to want to give it to them. So we're up for the task. We're up for the challenge. So I just kind of want to let you guys know what the data is telling us. And we're about to have a data checkpoint after the teachers post their 9-week grades and we get semester averages. And then we unpack the right score data and the STAR benchmark data. And one of our next parent meetings, we'll share that data just like we did today. That's our last slide. At this time, I'll open it up for Q&A if anybody has anything they want to ask or share. And you can just unmute and talk if you want to. All right, going once, going twice.
Hello, can you hear me?
I can hear you, Ms. Strickland. How you doing? Okay,
fine. How you doing?
I'm doing well. Thank you for asking.
I was late coming in. I was at work. But the first beginning of the meeting, I see this is being recorded. Will this be posted on the website to go back to the first beginning? I missed the first 15 minutes of it.
Without a doubt, it will be posted on the website, and I'm going to send it out in a dial out. I'm going to edit it a little bit, jazz it up to make you want to tune in. But I will definitely post it, and it'll be sent out tomorrow.
Okay.
And that way you can, you didn't miss much. We waited a little while, and I think you came in maybe on the talk about the pulse data.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay. So, all right. Thank you, Dr. Smith. Dr. Smith is one of our English teachers for seventh grade. First year phenomenal teacher. And, but she's a natural. You know, some people have it, and she's got it. So if your kid has the opportunity to take her class or just connect with her in general, they're in a great place. She's also a parent, not just in my school, but also at Alexander High School. So Dr. Smith, thank you for being invested in not just creating a future for our kids here, but also for, choosing Douglas County Schools to educate your family. All right, anything else from anyone?
I just wanted to echo Dr. Smith and say thank you for sharing this information. I'm sorry I joined a little bit late, but thank you for sharing this. And I look forward to watching the whole presentation and also you just letting us know any ways that we can help as parents to close some of these gaps and things that you all may need from us at the school.
So that's a great, Ms. Fulton, thank you so much for that. That reminded me. So be on the lookout for a video from me. I'll make it over the Christmas break after I have a chance to look at some of the data. And just, we will definitely be sending you some information about, please do this for us at home. We have a meeting coming up in February. That's a preparation parent meeting for the GMAS test in the spring. And that is the meeting where we'll dig into that, and it'll give you 2 months of good practice of things to do with your kid at home. So thank you so much, Ms. Fulton, for bringing that point up. I'm glad you said it. All right, Ms. Jones, my favorite Greek mythology name, Antigone Jones, is here. I love it. Thank you always coming and support. I appreciate you. All right, without further questions, we'll go ahead. Hey, Ms. Jones, how you doing?
I'm good.
Thank you for hanging in there with us again.
Oh, always.
Absolutely. Well, I will stop the recording and then we'll just go ahead and sign off. And I appreciate you guys coming. Look for an email blast with the link. And then I'll also put it on the website when I send that out. And without further ado, take care, guys. Have a great evening.